The final frontier. Let's leave this desperately overcrowded and brazenly overpriced planet and set foot where no man has ever been before.
Hey folks and fine people of the Blenderverse. Welcome to this short explanation video for a Starfield world shader for space renders I made for Blender. Well, at least I hope it turns out short. It is all about a node group I made to replace any HDRI in the Blender world shader with this beautiful, fully procedural 360 degree view of a starfield you see playing in the background of this fantastic science fiction render I made playing on your screen right now. A Blender file with the node group is available on my Gumroad page. The link to this is in the description of this video. At the time of recording this, the Starfield world shader is available as version 1.2. It seems very complete to me, so version 1.2 might as well be the final version. But I'm always open for user feedback and suggestions that might lead to further updates. So let's fade out this spacey music and take a look at the Blender file. To see what I'm doing, I'm dragging the compositing window smaller. We'll get to that later. Switch to rendered view and in the render settings under film disable the transparent display of the world background. This is important to see what you are doing. When rendering an image or an animation, the background needs to be set to transparent again, as the compositing node tree is configured to render shiny stars only on the background. But more on that later, let's take a look at the world shader first. The size master value is basically the scaling of the whole shader. The default value of 10 looks pretty okay. Drag the value towards 0 to scale up the stars and the nebulas. Or nebulae. For smaller stars, use relatively bigger values. The master size is clamped to values between minus 50 and 50. A master size value of 0 shows no stars at all and scales up the nebulas to a blur. The next value, called stars, just acts as a separator and has no use. There are stars of 3 different sizes spread all over this universe. And you can control the size of each group individually. Smaller values give you bigger stars in that group. And bigger values give you smaller stars. This is just a Blender shader thing. Each group is clamped to some specific values that make sense in their size. If you manually override the values, you can turn one group into the other group. As you can see, the default value for the small stars is 5, which is the size of the big stars. If you turn it to 50 or something, you have a lot more of these smaller stars. The emission strength value is the brightness of everything in that world shader. Here, a lower value means less brightness. The lowest value is 0.1 and you can barely see the stars. To quickly turn off the shader, override that with a value of 0. Brightness goes up to 100 and then it's also sparkly and shiny. The next value lets you set the brightness of the big stars separately. BG, of course, stands for background color. I tend to leave it black, but you can change it here. To see what the star fade color, which is the next option, is doing, I scale up the whole star field. The name is already telling you what it is doing. It is the color over which the stars fade from the star bright color to the background color we just played around with. There are 2 color sets possible, which both fade to the same background color. As noted on the node group, it is best to use fully saturated colors for the color fade, as the node group internally automatically desaturates the color over the fade. Big thanks and a shout out to the YouTube user Katsu. As I was playing around with Voronoi textures, which are obviously very good to make stars, but it just didn't look right and not very stylish and very crappy. So I looked around and found his Starfield YouTube tutorial, and there he fades from a bright color over another color to black. This makes it so much better, and I used his method here and made it easy for you to use in a Nodegroup, where you can globally change these colors. And let's get back to that Nodegroup. Nebula scaling, of course, scales the nebula. Values from minus 5 to 5 lead to very small nebulas, while values closer to 0 give a nice wide space nebula. Nebula shuffle changes the appearance of the nebula by manipulating the W value of the 4D noise texture that defines its form. You can set two different colors for the nebulas for a lot of different and varied results. Again, use more saturated colors for better results.
The Nodegroup handles the color internally. The final slider is the rotation vector. Use it to rotate the starfield on all three axes, like on a mapping node.
Let's take a look at the compositing node tree now. That is responsible for drawing the flares around the shiny stars and adding a bit more subtle enhancements. For this node tree to work, make sure that in the render settings under film you enable transparency. This removes the background, in this case our Starfield world shader, from the actual render. In the view layer properties, enable the passes for the environment. You find it under light other environment. This brings our world shader back into the compositing as a new environment output socket in the render layers node. Hit F12 to render the image so that we can see what we are doing in the compositor. Once rendering has finished, jump into the compositor. It's very simple. The double framed Aqua Mix node switches between the James Webb Space Telescope hexaflares and a four-sided starshine that is supposed to look like the pictures Hubble took. Drag the mix factor to 0 for hexaflares, and a value of 1 gives you four-sided shiny stars. Since you probably want to reuse the star flares in your own projects, here's a short explanation how this compositing node tree setup works. As explained before, the environment path is the overall background, the world shader this is all about, the meat and bones of this tutorial, and the free file you can get on my Gumroad. After getting routed into the JWST node group, which stands for James Webb Space Telescope, the stars in the Starfield world shader start to glow with 6 stars, just like the new space images from the James Webb Space Telescope. The other route into the mix shader comes from a Blender glare node set to 4 streaks. Mixing these two variants of glow is not very effective. It's better to use either 1 or 0 as a mix value. When you follow the nodes, you will notice the main rendered image goes along the bottom row and has a transparent background because we just set this in the render settings. And with the alpha over nodes, the foreground image with transparent background gets placed over our shiny starfield. After that is another glare node and a lens distortion node for some extra colorful colors created in hyperspace. If you want to have these shiny star flares both on the background starfield and on your foreground objects, you don't have to set all these settings for transparency and the environment path and routing it all over the place in the compositor. Instead, you just route the render output through a glare node or my JWST compositing node group. You can also import this JWST hexaflare node group into another project and have hexaflares on everything unrelated to space and stars and everything, just for style reasons. And you can find that whole file for free on my Gumroad. The link is of course in the video description. If you can afford it, leave a tip. Do the usual YouTube things, click every button under this video, unless it's the dislike button, rather like and subscribe and connect on social media. Take a look around this channel and be pleasantly surprised. Tell your friends, tell your teachers, tell your mom, tell your new favorite polygonic pet monkey about the new James Webb Space Telescope Starfield world shader and blender.
So, I really hope this video turned out short yet informative. And so I say goodbye and see you on the other side. TT out.